Welcome to the Get It Done podcast. I'm your host, Jimmy Ryan. Today we are interviewing Craig Sewing. Let's get it done.
So,
you know what? Like, I could edit that out, but we are not editing this out. This is a non-edited podcast. We're having this real deal. And before we get started, the Get It Done podcast is sponsored by Team Get It Done. We're interviewing Craig Sewing. We got this correct. Craig is the creator of the American Dream TV show. He's actually the host of it, which has been nominated for an Emmy. He is the CEO of Ignite Media and Volo. He got to start working for MTV, got into the loan officer field, and then full circle got back into media. And he's the author of The American Dream 2.0, which is an Amazon bestseller. Craig, welcome to the Get It Done podcast.
And I've never sued anybody. Right? I always say, man, my best friends still say suing because it kind of looks like that. And like, no, it's sewing. It's like, oh, exactly how it looks. So,
It probably was like 15 seconds prior. I'm asking for the proper pronunciation, and I'm literally messing it up. So, heartfelt apologies, and I want to say it the right way. So, you know, that's quite a laundry list of accolades, brother. Like, I mean, there's a lot of people that I've interviewed, and I mean, it's Amazon bestseller. You know, working for MTV, and in like, look, I've seen your show on TV. It's a great show. I mean, what a great. What an epic list of accomplishments. Is there anything maybe that I missed?
There's a lot of failures in between all those. So that's what 20 years to be an overnight success, I think is the term. Look, what it all is, Jimmy, is it's the entrepreneurial journey. I am from Missouri. I'm in San Diego now, but I was mowing lawns and shoveling snow in Missouri to buy baseball cards when I was a kid. And so I've always kind of had that entrepreneurial spirit. MTV was really, it sounds cool, but I was an intern. I was getting coffee for Carson Daly and on that show TRL. That was back when they actually used to play music on MTV. Now it's just garbage for teenagers. So that's where it started. Then I tripped and stumbled into the real estate mortgage business, and that entrepreneurial journey just continued to evolve. And genuinely, a lot of failures in between all of those milestones, and there'll probably be a lot more. But over the years, it's been a 20-year run, man. We've done a few things.
That's awesome. Well, we're going to get right into it then. I was literally watching Carson Daly on TRL back in the day.
I probably gave him the coffee that day.
Literally Carson Daly was for sure to a, I don't know, anywhere from 14 to 18-year-old in those years, the most famous person in the whole wide world. He could do no wrong. He was like the coolest dude. But yeah. But anyway, so, okay, the Get Done podcast is really all about, just like you were talking about, the failures, the come-up story. We use Elon Musk as an example. He's a great story from going to $1 million to $1 billion. And that's a great story, awesome, fine. But what we're really focused on is the zero to a million story, the come-up story. And the best place to start that is, you already mentioned that you started your life in Missouri. So where were you born? What was your early years like? What did your parents do, mother and father? What did they do for a living? How'd you start your life?
Pretty simple. You know, my parents still live in the house I was raised in today. So I was born in St. Louis, walked to school every day, went to the neighborhood high school, went to the University of Missouri, and quickly became a college dropout. So, you know, there it is in a nutshell. But, you know, when we talk about Missouri, you got to remember your roots. I'm happy where I came from. I'm proud of where I came from. Modest beginnings, Midwest values. A lot of very successful people have way crazier stories than I do. I'm not going to manufacture one. I have good parents, good family, but came from modest beginnings. And, you know, even my dad was an entrepreneur in his own way. He had a little cafeteria in St. Louis, Missouri. In fact, I'll share a quick story with you about that if you want.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's not so much about me as it is my dad. It's a story I'm really fond of. Growing up, so we lived in an area about 20 minutes outside of St. Louis. So where I'm from, and even today, diehard Cardinal fan, St. Louis Cardinal baseball. It's a religion where I'm from. So every summer, my mom would take me into town to drop me off with my dad, who'd take me to a baseball game about once a year, once a summer. And so my dad ran this little cafeteria called the Salad Bowl and didn't even serve salad. So don't even ask me why. So it was a little cafeteria. And the story of the Salad Bowl is pretty unique. So my mom would take me up there, and 90% of his customers and the people that worked with him were African-American. Now, that doesn't sound like that big a deal in 2022 or whenever this might be listened to, but it was started by his dad in 1945. This is pre-Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So racism still exists today. Imagine back then. So every day, my dad and his brothers would eat lunch with his customers. And that was something that his dad, Elmer Sewing, really bragged about. In fact, he was shunned for it because, like me, they're white, and here they are serving the African-American community before civil rights. And my grandpa was quoted as saying, "We don't see color and we'll eat with anybody who wants to have a meal with us." And so now there's a point to this story, and it's completely random how you ask the question. So I'm sorry if I'm taking this down a rabbit
trail. No, I love the rabbit holes. Let's do it. Let's go down.
So back to the baseball game. So my mom would take me up there as a little toddler and drop me off. Now my dad could have put me in the back office, finish up work, come grab me, gone to the game. Instead, he made me go through the line like everybody else and pay Millie, the gal who worked the cash register. Millie worked there for 50 years, man. 50 years she worked there. And then I would sit down and have dinner with my dad's customers and hear their stories. And, you know, at that time, I didn't realize I was learning anything. I just was a kid that wanted to go to a baseball game. But, you know, you get older and you kind of reflect on your life and who raised you. Well, my dad and his brothers did that every single day. They ate with their customers. And I think for me, it was a great lesson that wasn't necessarily being taught in spoken words versus actions, the importance of relationships. And so back from St. Louis, Midwest values, this is where I came from. And he and his brothers were beloved in that the heart of St. Louis, in that community. And man, this is before Facebook and social media and Yelp. Their community, like, your business came from what people talked about you in the neighborhood. And they loved my dad and his brothers because he was one of them and all the things that they did. And I mean, they had mayors and city council members hold banquets there. And they were really fond of my dad. And even though it was called the Salad Bowl and didn't serve salad, I later learned, like not that long ago, that the reason Elmer Sewing had the foresight, the marketing genius to call it the Salad Bowl, is just like a salad has a lot of mixed ingredients, so does a restaurant with people. So I thought that was really a fascinating come full circle story around that cafeteria. But anyway, so that's where I came from. You know,
what'd they sell? What was the food? What was the food there?
Cafeteria, man. You know, what was their best food? Fish, fried chicken. Amazing pies and pastries. The food was incredible, but it was so low key. I mean, I'm talking very, very low key. And there's other great parts of the story as well. I mean, they employed people that were handicapped. They did so much for charity. I mean, it really is remarkable. And so when I say things like Midwest values, a lot of people pay lip service to that. But that's, you asked how I was raised. There you go. That's a story.
I mean, it's a soft spot for me for sure. I mean, I grew up in Wisconsin. I mean, it's a similar spot. I mean, except that everybody here absolutely despises the Cardinals because generally they beat the Brewers in everything. And for years and years and years, I've beat the Brewers. But here, the Midwest values is, you're right. It's more of that community feel. And back in the day, like I'd even say, like pre 2000. It was, you know, everybody, you'd ride your bike everywhere as a kid. You would, different times for sure. And that's
really locked the door and hard work meant something and building relationships and social capital. Look, it's funny that we're talking about this. My book, not to give myself a plug over there, but genuinely the book that I wrote is about old school techniques with new school technology, old school techniques, working hard, relational capital, networking, things of that nature, mixed with the new world of digital and social. I don't think you can have one without the other. Social media, it's here to stay. It's important. It's not a fad. If you are in business, a marketer, sales, mortgage, real estate, and you deny power of social, then you really, you're going to become outdated really quickly.
100%.
But you can't also deny the old school thing that got us here. And I think if you can find that happy blend between the two, you're going to have a lot of success this year and moving forward.
Well, that's what you exemplify in your show. I'm a huge fan of your show, and it's really, it is about that relationship, and you're kind of developing one right with a video camera, but it's really, that's how you connect with, you know, thousands of people, hundreds of thousands of people. And if you don't have that relation, if there's not a real basis for it, it's just, it's not going to work. You're not going to connect. People are going to change the channel, I guess, yeah. to say it a different way. So, okay. Got your start out in Midwest values type of a environment. A good friend of ours, Rene Rodriguez, he talks about this at Amplify. He says, you know, a lot of the things that we do in our lives generally stem from things that happen between 9 and 13 years old. And generally what we try to do is, and years later, we're doing this. We're trying to either honor our past or heal our past. How are you trying to heal? How are you trying to honor?
Oh. All right. So I don't want to manufacture stories for you. So let me give you something authentic. 9 to 13, I was just a kid that wanted to play baseball and basketball. You know, I had two older sisters. I wasn't around. I was on the local basketball court and I was playing sports. You know, that was for me. Didn't really fit in very well. Wasn't one of the popular kids. And kind of, I mean, for being someone who now has a TV show, the funny thing is I'm an introvert, but being an extrovert pays better. So I think growing up, wasn't the popular kid in school. And ultimately what ended up happening is when I went to the University of Missouri, it was kind of like, I felt connected to something. And I liked the big crowd. I liked being a part of that. And ultimately, you know, there's no story you can point your finger to that's like this broken story and that's why he accomplished so much, because we're all still trying to accomplish things. But I do think for me, I've always been competitive. I've always had that entrepreneurial spirit. And then really in college, you know, when I mentioned earlier that I'm a college dropout, I had fun in college. I was partying and not getting good grades, not going to school. And ultimately I tripped and stumbled and found my way into this crazy real estate and mortgage business. And I think a lot of that competitive spirit from my past allowed me to succeed in that industry. And, you know, where does that all come from? Probably competition, being an entrepreneur. But, you know, I don't have the broken stories, I think, that that required healing that are any more significant than others. Others have had it a lot harder than I have, is what I would say.
Well, for sure. And I think that the way I think you... I mean, here, I'm going to connect the dots. I think the way that you would honor it then is that, like, look, you mentioned, like, look, I'm an introvert. But extrovert pays better. I love that meme. We're memeing that. That's a great quote. But here, you didn't fit in. And here you are running a TV show, highlighting loan officers to help them fit in.
Yeah. You know, it's, I hated, I mean, when you talk about people that hate public speaking, like, I was number one. I hated public speaking because growing up, I was it wasn't just the youngest in my family. I was the youngest of all cousins and all this. I got picked on. I just hated being in the public eye. And what I ultimately, as you get older and you're kind of finding your path, what I hated worse was fear. And I had the opportunity to host a radio show. This would have been in 2009. And this work kind of all came full circle. The MTV thing was an intern in 2001. I lived in New York City weeks before 9/11 happened. I just moved, 9/11 happens, tripped and stumbled into mortgage. It was 2009 that I had the opportunity to have a radio show here in San Diego. I hated public speaking. There was no social media. We're doing a podcast here today. I'm talking like radio, 7 a.m. live to tape. And I never looked at it, Jimmy, as, well, I got so much smart stuff to say, even though I thought I had some things to say, but I always looked at it relationally. How could I leverage a show to invite other people on and share their story? And ultimately by doing that and really making it about them, not me, I somehow figured out this kind of communication media thing. And that ended up being a journey that I loved and where I really moved my entire career path to. And so, but it did come from that introverted self. It still exists today. But funny that I would find myself as a CEO of a media company, considering that backstory.
Brother, you're describing a lot of my story, truly. And like, I failed speech class, for instance, and yet I think I'm a little bit opposite of you. Maybe not in the fear standpoint. Like, I feel the fear, but I just do it anyway. And like, I'm going to do it clunky just because, like, yeah, I hate fear more. I kind of like wear that with pride. And go back though, just a second. So I want to put a bow on school and high school and early years. What was your, you said basketball was big for you. Did you play it as far as a sport? Was that a big thing for you in high school? What was your first job and first car?
Okay. So big into sports, hit my limit. I think there's a movie that came out in the 90s called White Men Can't Jump. that was about me. And so I hit a certain, okay, you're not going to make it any further. Baseball, similar, except, you know, I couldn't throw the ball hard enough. But, you know, I love sports. You learned a lot about teamwork and competition, all that. It was so valuable in hindsight. But as far as yes, about my first job, shoveling snow, you know, mowing lawns. And I made a business around it. And I would save, I'd buy baseball cards, and I'd walk 3 miles to buy the Ricky Henderson rookie card. I remember a time I actually got into an auction, was up there for hours one day on the four neighbors' lawns that I mowed. So that's really where it all started. Now, I had some crappy jobs along the way. I worked at Sparrow's Pizza. I think it was when I was 14, umpired baseball games. So, you know, growing up, the theme here is I was working, though. You know, it wasn't, you know, parents just giving me money. That didn't happen really ever. They were supportive. You know, they helped with college. But growing up, it was always getting out there and working and making a buck, whether it was my own doing, mowing lawns, shoveling snow, or getting being on someone else's payroll. I was always doing something to make money.
I mean, that's awesome. And
first car, Nissan Stanza.
What was it? A Nissan Stanza? Yeah.
A Nissan Stanza stick shift. It was a piece.
What year was it?
Oh, I knew you were going to ask that. So if I was 16, and I don't know, but it was a piece. I mean, it was a piece. The stick shift. You remember stick shifts?
Like, yeah, I do. My first car was a stick shift too. I can't believe like that's not a thing at all. Like I thought it was fun, but I had a Mustang, and the coolest thing about it is that I could say that it was a Mustang, but it barely started. It was a 4-cylinder, 4-speed. And like the flywheel didn't work. So like I would have to like push it in gear so that the flywheel, like teeth of it were missing. So I'd have to spin it so that the starter would engage so I could start the thing. I mean, my goodness, it's funny. I can't even picture a Nissan Stanza though. What is it? Is that like a hatchback? What does a Nissan Stanza look like? You're muted. I think you're muted.
Am I still muted?
No, now you're good. Now you're good.
Okay. So, hey, we're live, man. Got to roll with it, right?
Brother, I love, that's the best part about this. I love mistakes. That's just the best part. I love the fact that people know that this is real and that's just not edited. So anyway, go ahead.
Well, you know what though? Here's why. Because people's bullshit meter is at an all-time high.
100%.
And people would rather see unscripted and imperfect than perfectly scripted. And so that's really a big message of what we do in media, is that we encourage imperfections. We encourage authenticity. And the reality is that engages with people more. But if my mic goes out, let me know. I'll switch mics.
No, for sure. So like to say it differently, you mentioned authenticity. I believe that people crave authenticity more so than ever, especially right now, because like, for instance, good friend of mine, Kyle Draper, we talk about this, is that if the person that you are off of social media is different than the person you are on social media, you're going to really struggle with social media. And we all know that friend that does their story every day and they give a sales pitch for something, or like a pitch for, you know, I don't know, like like the makeup product type people or whatever. And then you talk to them in real life. They're nothing like
a life coach that's 20 something years old.
Yeah. Like, or like,
is she about life?
Yeah. Come on. I mean, but the thing is that like, give me something of value, but I get it. But also, I don't know. Show me you as a real person walking the dog and like, I don't know. People crave authenticity. I think that's pure end of story.
Well,
and
you know, piggybacking on that, Jimmy, I mentioned I had a radio show that started at 7 in the mornings on Sundays. That was live to tape. We were getting up at the ass crack of dawn, 5:30 driving, and I can't believe we actually got guests to agree to it. But there wasn't this big social media thing. There wasn't podcasts. So like people really liked the idea of it. But what ended up happening is it went from a morning show to a 2 in the afternoon show. Then I got the opportunity to have a 6 p.m. daily show. And then it went from 6 to 8. So I was doing a daily radio show every day here in San Diego. And the thing that I learned is I had no time to prep because I had my other career that actually paid me going on. And so I learned really as, again, an introvert to it's easy to duplicate if it's authentic. Right. It's the people that are disingenuous or in some cases dishonest. They have a hard time. They become a dog chasing their tail a bit because it's tough to remember. Right. But when you're authentic all the time, telling the truth and being real is actually very easy. And that's really a valuable lesson for people today in this content driven world that I think will help them come out of their shell and do more content because it's important for every business now.
100%. Gary Vee says it. I mean, document, don't create. And like, look, I think that people take that way too far in some ways. And but regardless, like here, you're not doing a daily show. Like people ask me, like, what do you do to prep for this? I don't know. I kind of looked on LinkedIn a little bit at people's profiles before I, you know, hit like the 10 minutes before and hit record.
I'll let your audience know before we started this, you and I spoke for 2 whole minutes.
Yeah.
And you said my last name properly. And then we came in and you said it improperly. That was Jimmy's prep. He's like, is this how you say it? I'm like, yes. And he comes on and he says it the opposite way.
I mean, it's because it's true. I mean, but truthfully, if you're going to listen to my podcast for me, you're going to get me, you know, it's not going to be somebody different each time. Yeah. But okay. So bring us to college. So, okay. You get to, you're driving your Nissan Stanza around. We bring ourselves to college. Did you after high school, because I think this is a pivotal moment for a lot of people. And did you after high school know, like, look, I'm going to college and it's going to be for this? And,
no.
And I mean, we already know you eventually dropped out, but I guess what did you know even where you were going to go? What was that transition like?
No, not at all. And so the dropout story is kind of interesting, really. I mean, it really is what ended up giving me this crossroads of this is your time to go down the wrong path or the right path. So got to college, University of Missouri, number one journalism school in the country, started there, didn't really find my way, rolled into communications. I really did enjoy media. I found myself enjoying camera work and directing and different shots. And if you watch a sports game and you know, recently the Super Bowl, you just see all these cool shots. Like I really loved that. And I started to find that I loved it. And then I got that job with MTV in New York City. So Missouri kid gets a job out in New York City. Well, between landing that and going out and coming back, I actually, you want to talk about being real. This is when I was 20 years old. I made a big mistake. I drank and I got behind a wheel of a car. I got pulled over and I got a DUI. Thank God nobody got hurt. And, you know, I got a DUI, which, you know, not something I'm proud of, but it really did change my course. And so I was able to do the MTV gig, came back to the University of Missouri, and they had just started a program that if you had gotten a DUI on campus, back then it was called a DWI, driving while intoxicated versus driving under the influence. Anyway, so I had a DWI 20 something years ago, and I didn't have school. I was suspended for a semester because I got it on campus. And they ended up canceling the policy because they got into a lot of lawsuits with parents and stuff like that. But this happened to me. While that happened to me, I mean, my mom is just like, what's going to happen with this kid? Like, he's headed down the wrong path, kicked out of school. And really, it was just a semester and I was going to go back. Well, what ended up happening is I opened up a newspaper. I found a job as a telemarketer for this thing called mortgage. I was like, I'm broke, just back from New York, need a job. So I went in. I never made one telemarketing call. They said, hey, you should learn about this loan officer thing. Okay. So day two, I'm an assistant loan officer for a company that had five people, you know, growing this company to 300 people, becoming one of the biggest mortgage companies in Missouri. That's what actually brought me out to San Diego. And what was really funny about that whole story is I there was a time that I was doing, so then school kicks back in. So now I have a full-time career. And by the way, making way more money than a 20-year-old deserves to make in any industry. You remember those days in the mortgage wild, wild west. And I was doing school and that. So skipping all my classes while going to be a mortgage loan officer. And then I'd have these finals popped up and I had been to school all semester. And so one day I'm at a Cracker Barrel studying and it's the day before my test. And I basically, I don't know if you would have called it a panic attack or what, but I just took my book, I shut it. And I just said to myself, I quit school. And the next day I went to work and I just stopped and I continued down that mortgage path and the rest was history. But getting to your point or your question, I didn't get go to college thinking this would be the path. And while I was in college, I was really lost half the time. I was partying. I was dumb, really dumb. And I got out of there lucky that from that story that I'm not proud of, I didn't hurt anybody or anything like that. But what it ended up happening is I kind of had a choice in life. Are you going to keep going down this path and, for lack of better words, become a complete loser? Or are you going to do something about it? And I was living with three or four roommates. They were getting up, partying, doing all this stuff. And man, I was putting on a tie at 21 years old, going to work every day while they were partying upstairs. And I went into career mode like that. So college lost, but I got into career mode way before any of my friends and a lot of people. I was off to the races by age 20 because of the failures of college and the mistakes I made.
That's really incredible. So you open a newspaper and you're asking somebody to advertise with you and they happen to run the telemarketing type of call center thing for the mortgage
company? They were the advertiser. I was calling for a job for probably $7 an hour.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Gosh, I love that so much. That's like, I mean, you, I was just saying that you're describing my start. I literally started.
Everybody who got into real estate or mortgage has some weird way they got into it.
Everybody.
If you find that inception point, like it's a, most people have a pretty phenomenal story how they got into that industry.
Right.
And a lot of people got wiped out of it. The successful ones made it through and proved to be, okay, these are people that are very driven. And that's who's left in the mortgage and real estate industry now are really very, very hardworking, entrepreneurial, marketing mindset. I mean, to be in mortgage is tough now.
I totally agree. Right. Back then, it was a 20 question test that if you failed, you could take it literally the next day.
Yeah.
And now it's tough. I mean, it really is. It's tough. You have to have good credit. You have to like, there's a lot of, the barrier to entry is much higher and you make a lot less money also than you used to. So like, you're right. You're talking like 21 years old, making money that you shouldn't be capable of making. That's what it was. And you could literally do it as a loan officer assistant telemarketing. I mean, and then just fall right into it. Okay. So you start this company. It's a small time thing. You helped them grow to 300. It was a big company. And then you moved to San Diego. Why did you move to San Diego?
Really? I was just ready to get out of Missouri. You know, it's cold. It's cold there. So we, you know, at that time I kind of just wanted to move. The guy who owned the company wanted to move as well. And I mean, you want to talk about business planning? We just looked at the map on the wall in his office and he just goes, what do you think is the coolest place to live? Oh, I don't know. I've been to Iowa. You know, like here I am 21 years old. I'm like, I haven't really been very many places. And I don't know who in the room said San Diego, but, you know, sounded like a great place. California dreaming, right? So we just said, let's go to San Diego. A month later, we got things kind of dialed in where we were in Missouri, and we went out and we opened up a branch in San Diego. He and the other guys who came out all ended up going back to Missouri. And that was a time where I decided to open my own mortgage company. It would have been 2006-ish. Moved on from there.
Perfect time to open a mortgage company in 2006. My goodness.
Right, yeah, perfectly timed, right?
Because I got into the mortgage industry in October of 2007, and people thought I was absolutely nuts. You're getting into the industry when everybody's getting out of it. But I guess, I mean, here, I can guess what happens, but you start a mortgage company in 2006. What happens in 7, 8, and 9?
Debt. So, you know, what's interesting is, so back then they used to be net branches, and now I know that the industry's reshaped and changed how it all works. But so I had a net branch with a company called Benchmark Mortgage. They were a great company, ended up being their number one branch nationwide out of 300 something for a while. So this was our deal. And, you know, 2008 happens, throws a grenade into everything. Here's the thing though, I'll never forget this. Stuart Hunter, who is, I believe, I don't know his exact title, one of the owners of Benchmark, is still there, great guy. And I remember he did a call. There were no Zooms then, so it was a call, and we're all on speakerphone. It was with all the top branches across the country. This is just when the market started imploding. And I remember he said, look, gang, this is going to be about survival. And man, I was in my 20s, like, I was young and dumb. And right. I was like, survival? I'm like, we're killing it. You know, I thought I was the cat's meow in this industry, 20-something years old, had my own branch. And the thing about it is we were doing a paper the whole time. So refis, but a paper refis and FHA refis and VA. There was, I mean, here and there, there'd be a subprime deal, but not really. So when that was happening, it was starting just to sink everybody around us. But I mean, we did really well into 2008 and 9 and 10, but we had the realization that in this business, and I know a lot of your audience isn't necessarily related to the industry, so I don't want to get too confusing here, but we needed to get to a place to where we were referral only, not spending so much money on marketing and mail. And that's where media really played in, because we developed a purchase model, relationally driven, less money on marketing, more time and energy invested into relationships. And media was our catalyst to hyper accelerate some guy in Missouri who nobody knows to really growing our branch and our opportunities here in Southern California. So for me, like the market, when it hit, didn't hit us that hard at first because we were doing a lot of A paper.
I mean, that makes it sense.
Ultimately, yeah, like everyone, we had to adjust, and you know, disruption creates opportunities.
I mean, to give back in the day, a lot of people weren't even FHA licensed or full legal. Full legal FHA certified or whatever the technical term is for it. But like, that's because you wouldn't need to. You'd just flip it to no doc and you pay a quarter point higher and you'd close it that way and probably make more money and throw a prepay on it or whatever the heck it is. I didn't know any of that. I've never done a subprime loan, but like, I remember the company I started at, they didn't do FHA because they didn't have that license. And then like, that was a really big thing. And then all of a sudden the line out the door for getting
you didn't need to. Like. Right. At that time, it was like, oh, can you fog that mirror? Okay, cool. Here's your loan.
Right.
125% loans. You know, this is always befuddling to me. There was a loan program I remember. Everyone's probably heard of the stated income loan. You state your income. There you go. All right. And I know that's tighter now, but there's a place for that for self-employed people. There's a loan called the NINA ME. Stood for no income, no asset, no employment. Like, you literally didn't even need to prove that you had a job to get financing. That's how stupid it was. And you wonder why there was this housing bubble, which it does if we're going to make it of value to anyone tuning in here today. I also think that gives a lot of confidence that today's housing market is a lot more secure because there's real demand, cash buyers, better credit. None of that flimsy fog and mirror financing exists. I mean, I'm sure there's some, but I mean, not like it was.
Less than 1%. I mean, I would say the majority of people are doing regular types of loans, and I mean that's the way that it should be. And I believe it's only going to get more streamlined and more, I mean, legit. I mean, official. Majority of the bad actors got out of it in those years.
Yep.
Bring us to 2009 is when you start your radio show. What was the deciding factor with that? I mean, was it that, like, look, I'm moving to this relational based thing? Was it more about, hey, I need a reason to call a real estate agent, not to just have coffee with them?
Yeah, look, we recognized the content game before there was such thing as a content game. There was no Gary Vee back then. I mean, right. He was. I think that's probably about when he wrote Crush It, somewhere in that ballpark. But the world has changed dramatically. We were actually spending a lot of money on advertising, and there was a radio show host here in San Diego that was, he would just give these amazing endorsements of these companies. And I was like, man, I need him to endorse us like that. And we'd launched a credit repair company. He needs to endorse our credit company like that. So we actually were going in there to advertise. And we met this radio show host. His name was Mikey, the Mikey Show. And we sat down with him, and of course he's vetting us. Is he going to give us an endorsement or whatever? Well, there was a sales guy there. When Mikey left the room, he said, you know, for what you guys are willing to spend, you could literally host your own radio show. And we're like, huh? Like, I was writing a blog at the time, so I had something to say. And so that came to us. And I mean, we were signing the papers the same day. We thought it was the greatest idea. But again, we didn't look at it as, we're so smart, let's just go tell the world all these knowledgeable things about mortgage and real estate, which can be a boring topic.
Right.
We looked at it as, what an opportunity to invite in community leaders and thought leaders onto our show to give them an opportunity to share their story. And even then, taking pictures and behind the scenes and making it fun for them and sending them copies of the show. So it was always a relational play for us. And then what ended up happening is, we were buying our airtime. We were, you know, we're paying thousands of dollars a month for it. And then I had the opportunity to go on to a weekend show. So Saturday at like 2:00. Well, I'm walking my dog one day, and I get this call from a financial advisor named Dave Elhoff, and still friends with Dave today. And he's like, Sewing. Dave smokes cigars. Like, Sewing. I love your show. I'm like, what? Who's this? You listen to my show? My own mom doesn't listen to my show. And he's a financial advisor that advertises on another one of the networks. So he listens to the station all the time. He's like, love your show. It's different. And he's like, I want to sponsor it. And I'm like, how much? Yeah. And he's like, how much would it cost? I had no idea. I didn't have a media kit. I was like, $1,000 a month. He's like, that it? I was like, yeah. Done. Well, now all of a sudden I'm getting paid, right? So I ended up kind of developing, okay, well, what if we got another? Next thing you know, we had a show that was costing us $3,600 a month, and we had 4,000 coming in on it. And I was like, we're getting paid $400 a month. And what the funny thing is that created this snowball that evolved over time to having a daily show, 2-hour daily show. Dave Savage partnered with him and did a national radio network deal. And then TV happened in 2013, and just one thing led to another, to where Ignite Media now has 60 employees. And we're last month alone, I saw 5 million views on just Facebook, not to mention CNBC and Bloomberg and travel. But it all started there. You know, it all was like a spark that just kind of led, and none of it happened quickly. I mean, we're talking like this is a 13-year deal to get to where we are. And I still struggle at times, you know, so it's never a perfect science. We haven't figured it all out.
So I really love, shout out to Dave Elhoff. Is that pronouncing it correctly?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think that's incredible, because it's like, you don't even know what to charge. I mean, like, truly, like, you probably could have said 2,000. He probably would have said, all right, you know?
He would have said pound sand. Trust me. I got to know Dave and what the value of our model was, and it 1,000 was probably stretching it a bit. But yeah, you know, but the funny thing is, it gave us the understanding that, okay, well, if someone's going to pay us $1,000, how do we give them, our math is always 10x. How do we give them $10,000 worth of value? If someone gives us 10 grand, how do we give them $100,000 of value? If someone gives us 10 bucks, how do you give them $100 worth of value? And so this is an important point, Jimmy, that I hope is of value to your audience.
Yeah,
When people look at getting money for things like this, getting sponsored or someone's going to invest in your company, we all know this term ROI. Someone's going to spend amount of money, X, and hopefully get Y. That's ROI. We always use the term ROR, return on relationship. If someone is going to spend money with us, it's not just how many people are going to call them that heard our show, because the truth is there weren't enough people listening to the damn show. You know, I mean, we didn't have an audience yet. And so we thought, all right, well, what else can we do to add value to this partner? And it was a lot more than that. You know, we would do events with them. We would refer them others. Next thing you know, we had a couple attorneys sponsoring, a credit sponsor. Well, that became a little mini network of cross-pollination and referrals. So all of a sudden that $1,000, it's like, well, yeah, I got a couple calls from the show, but I got a referral from over here and you guys helped me with my event over there. And eventually it's like, well, you guys are likable enough, right? And so that's what we did. And that's what we've always done, is we've really looked at ROR versus ROI and how can we add value in the relationship. And if you focus on that, and that gets back to that Salable story, remember relationships, there's a lot you can do in a content-driven world. And we found, we cracked that code pretty early.
I mean, you can just amplify it so much more. And I mean, but the thing is that, yeah, the return on relationship, that's really a great way to look at it. Because I've been trying to explain to people, like my dad, for instance, like, Jimmy, why are you doing a podcast? You're not like getting paid any money for this. And you're putting all this time and effort and money into it. But it's like, well, yeah, but I'm talking to the top people in my industry. I get an hour with them. What's that worth? Like I mentioned, yeah, I had an hour nine with Carl White. He makes $1 million a month. If you add that up and divide it up, it's literally $6,734 for the time that I spent with him. And we had pre-recording afterwards. So I look at it like, I'm at least—
He's a great guy. Bringing value to your audience. I mean, just talking to Carl in itself is a value.
100%. But here, like talking to you, I mean, this story is something that I think needs to be heard, because I think there's a lot of people that don't want to take it to that next level, or they're scared to, or they're living in that fear, or they're like, look, I'm an introvert, I don't want to do it. Yeah, but extrovert pays. I think like, you know, that's just like— yeah,
you know what I think a lot of it is? We're in a society now where everybody wants a quick fix.
Right.
And I'm guilty of it. You're guilty of it. It's hard not to. I mean, we're mad when Uber's 5 minutes late. Remember when there was no Uber? You know, so it's not like— the thing I just described to you is 13 years. Well, the MTV thing happened in 2001. You could call it 20 years.
Right.
You know, so, man, why would I start a podcast if nobody's listening? Why would I start a radio show if nobody's listening? Why would I start doing this on Facebook? I'm the last one to get to YouTube. It can be daunting, but it, you know, it's as simple as how to eat an elephant. You know, it's one bite at a time, right?
So bring us to 100%. Bring us to the American dream. So, I mean, like, look, you start this out as a radio show. You network with a bunch of people. You get this kind of like tribe, this tribe of people are all together. And, you know, you have Dave Savage on. You have all these epic people. Bring us to where it's at now today. And look, this is a business where, you know, you can pay to be on this. You can host this. There's a lot of different avenues that you're bringing value to the industry. I guess, what is the American dream and why should people tune in and why should a loan officer pay attention?
Yeah. You know, so there's different models of what we do, and I'll try and keep this punchy.
Do it.
We started in 2013. And what we did then was like anything. It was just, okay, we're rolling from radio into TV now. What does that look like? Way bigger and way better, way more expensive, but way more opportunities, right? So we rolled into that. It was 2016 that we launched Ignite Media, which I'm the CEO of Ignite Media. You also mentioned Volo. That's a tech play, different conversation, different day or later today, whatever. But the where it started to roll from, okay, this is a thing we are doing. For me, this became something that was like, this is something we can now model for others to do. And so that's where the American dream came in, is we had the ability, it would have been 2013 to have our own shows. 2016, we started taking it as a model across the country, really 2017. And so there's the real estate side of the show, and then there's the finance side of the show. On the real estate side, here's how I look at it. I always say that American Dream, our show, is a real show, not a reality show. People can turn on HGTV, half the shows are commercials, the other half is fake, and they're making their money on advertising dollars. And whether it's HGTV or just pop culture or the news, negativity sells, divisiveness sells, because advertisers make money on those clicks. That's why there's so much clickbait that exists out there. We are a B2B model first before we're a B2C show, business to business, business to consumer. So we partner with real estate and mortgage teams all across the country that have to be qualified and vetted. This isn't just a come one, come all thing, but we partner with them to be the voice of their market in a very real way. They live, work, and play there. We share the stories of their neighborhoods through the lens of top professionals. So on the real estate side, we're doing it with realtors all across the country, different markets. But on the mortgage side, man, I'm a mortgage guy at heart. I'm super passionate about our Financing the American Dream show because that's on CNBC, Bloomberg TV, Travel Channel, a lot on social. What's really cool about that is, look, in mortgage, it's always been like, well, what are the realtors doing today and will they give me a deal? You might have seen on the Super Bowl, Quicken Loans just opened up its own brokerage.
Right.
Bought a mortgage company. Zillow has a mortgage company. It is going to get a lot more challenging for realtors to get to the deal. So if you're a loan officer waiting on the realtor referral, it's going to get a lot harder for you. You've got to get in the game, the content game, the search game. It's going to be tough. And so what I love about the Financing the American Dream is we said to the mortgage guys, you don't live, work, and play in your area. You don't have a story to share. You don't need to create content. Your job is no longer just to memorize underwriting guidelines and interest rates. It's to get out there and be a thought leader of your own and share your story. And not just in a boring, oh, here's what the payment on this house is. It's like, no, let me show you the neighborhoods. Let me show you why first-time home buyers are buying here. Let me show you veterans. You have fought for our country. You deserve to own a piece of it. Let me show you a great place that veterans are buying homes with no money down. So it's lifestyle oriented. And it's, like I said, it's very real. So for the consumer that watches a show, like we were talking about earlier, it's not a bunch of bullshit. You know, it's not like, oh, this is just to make money on crap. It's like, no, these are real people doing the real thing. And there's an economic model to how it works. Well, find me a business that doesn't have an economic model.
Well, right.
So,
but the thing is that here you mentioned it's a real show and HGTV, like for instance, I'm friends with people, real estate agents that have been on HGTV, the whole thing's scripted, the whole thing. I mean, you watch any, I think that people know that like deep down, but they don't come right out and say, hey, just so you know, this whole show is complete bullshit, you know, yeah. Or like, we're going to look at three homes and, you know, which one do they go with? You know,
I've been on these shows. I've known people who've had seasons of these shows created around, you know, and like I said, there's a place for it. Heck, I watch right. Some of the stuff here and there, but
I'm not a hater, I guess, but at the end of the day, you're providing real authentic content. People are actually walking through the towns, talking about the towns. And what I love the most about it is the highlighting of the loan officer, because I think that a lot of the times, and I know you're passionate about it, you're a mortgage guy, but I don't know. I guess this is really just loan officer centric. It's just like, we're always like the second people, you know, like for instance, on HGTV, it would be like, then they went and got a loan with Joe Schmo, and here he is, and then go right
know,
back.
You know what you guys need to do in mortgage? Here's what you need to do. You've got to stop wiring the money at the close. What you've got to start doing is showing up with a suitcase of the loan money and and having $600,000 pushed from the buyer to the seller so people could see the money of a $1 million purchase. They'd be like, wow. But instead, it's just a wire. You're the guy behind the guy. Dealing with the underwriting guidelines, and people don't realize how complicated it is. I always say that it's one thing to find your dream home. It's another thing to finance it. Without the financing, it doesn't matter. But if you started actually, if the mortgage industry said, you know what, no more wires, you got to show up at the closing table and we're going to drop $1 million in the middle of the table, that would make it more interesting. But right,
people would be watching it like, wow.
Probably a lot more robberies than escrow companies, but you get the point.
Well, absolutely. Well, you know, I want to be, I really love this interview and I want to be super respectful of your time. There's a few questions that I ask everybody that comes on the show and I want to make sure that I get these out. So
cool.
First one is this. Do you feel like you ever had a big break?
I think that I was born in the United States of America, you know, like, I'm alive. We've all have big breaks. There are people that receive Social Security benefits here in this country that get paid more than doctors in other countries. You know, I don't want to get into politics, but there's all this talk about the borders, right? I don't care what side of the political fence, no pun intended, you're on. Millions of people went into this country, not out of it, right? So there's not a whole lot to complain about. The big break, I think, is that there are no excuses. You have everyone has every opportunity to accomplish something for themselves. Some people don't want it. Some people do. But the opportunity is for you. So my biggest break is just living in probably the greatest opportunity in the history of mankind for connectivity, for marketing, sales. So if you have something that you're really passionate about, you have a medium now that didn't exist. When I told that story about the salad bowl, they had to rely on their customer talking to another customer, and then hopefully one day that other customer showed up. Now, just go share a Yelp review, right? So I really would just say that's it. This country provides you so much opportunity, but a lot of people make excuses or say it's too hard or everyone's already doing it. There's always been excuses. The fact of the matter is we are in a country that millions of people went into, not out of. And until that changes, there's your break and mine.
Wow. What an incredible answer. I love that. That's great.
It's true, man. Along the way too. I mean, people have looked out for me. I've had great teammates. I have not got here without a lot of failures, and I've not got here on my own. So the biggest break I think all of us have in common. We were born here. We have a chance. But, you know, there's been a gazillion of them along the way too.
Right. 100%. Love that. If you were to do it all over again, Craig, what would you change?
Well, you know, you can't have regrets because we wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be on the Jimmy Ryan show if something changed. It could have been like Back to the Future. I could have done one thing and I've never made this show. I mean, I might have left instead of a right. So I don't know. You got to enjoy the journey. Something that I work at even today is enjoying the journey. That's where, I don't know. There's certainly things I did in my younger days that maybe I wish I didn't. But I think, you know, a mantra of mine that I work on, I meditate every morning. Like every morning I approach my day with, green juice, journaling, meditation, now yoga, working out, stretching. It takes me 3 hours in the morning to really get myself prayer, to get myself situated for the day. And I think something that I always have to be conscious of is always going a million miles an hour, always wanting that big thing. Next thing you know, life's going to be over on me. So stopping, enjoying the journey and being present, that's not a passing. I don't know if that really answers your question, but for me, just if I looked in the past and even to today, it's just making sure to slow it down, enjoy the journey. What's in the way is the way. And that's something all of us need to be reminded of, because otherwise we're just going to, what's the point? There's no dollar amount you can make that's going to give you happiness.
100%.
Everybody wants to make money, but it's not going to be the thing. The thing that gives you happiness is actually a lot simpler than that. It just requires slowing down and being present. So that's a thing that I've learned over the years that maybe in the past I wish I would have been better at, but I do work at it every day and it's really important to me.
Brother, that's a fire answer. I love it. Was there ever a time, Craig, you thought about giving up?
No. No. I mean, do I get stressed out? Do I hate it? Do I gripe? Do I get in bad moods? All those things. Do I fail? Yes. But giving up? No. You know, Will Smith has the best line on that. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but he talks about training for a movie or something and how he'll go up against anyone on a treadmill or something to that effect. But he says, I can't lose because I will either win or I will die. There is no in between. I will win or I will die trying. And I know he meant that metaphorically. And that's kind of how I mean it in my answer here as well, is that struggled, ticked off, failed, yes, yes, and yes, but giving up, never. In fact, I would tell you that when things are going well in my world is actually when I'm the most stressed out, when I'm forced, remember the college story? When I'm forced to make a change or my back's against the wall, I actually do pretty well in those moments. So you know, for me, that actually allows me to replace fear at times with faith. And when you have that, you're kind of in a good spot, kind of unstoppable.
I mean, you said it yourself, you hate fear more.
Right. Failure will happen. Giving up is not an option.
Love it. All right, last question. To set it up, there is a young Craig Sewing out there. Maybe they're getting their start in the Midwest, growing up in Missouri. Maybe they're a Cardinals fan. Maybe they don't fit in. Maybe they're an introvert. Maybe they're shoveling snow, mowing lawns, working at Sparrow's Pizza, driving their Nissan Stanza. Maybe they're dropping out of college, not sure what they're going to do. Maybe they're lost in college. Maybe they're considering starting a real estate show. Maybe they're starting a media company. What advice would you give to someone looking to get it done?
It's a phenomenal question and very well framed. So, I mean, and there's things when you reference it that way, I almost think of my older self, my younger self years ago, and what advice could I have been given? I'll tell you, the world is so different now. You know, I can't even look back to my younger self and say, you should have done this, because the world is so different. So if I was talking to somebody today, I mean, it really, I'd go old school, man. You know, I'd really talk to that younger self in a 2022 kind of world about manners, loyalty, integrity, working hard, staying off social media, except where it might make sense, right? Unfollowing the bad people, be a sponge for knowledge. You know, honestly, man, it really gets, not to endorse my book again, but it really gets back to the theme of combining old school techniques with new school technology. You can't have one without the other if you're an entrepreneur or in business or whatever it may be. Hard work, building relationships, social capital, integrity, loyalty, old school stuff that's getting forgotten today by the younger generation. The older generation isn't paying attention to what the younger generation knows, though. These guys were born with a mouse in their hand. Connectivity, marketing, social, those things are here to stay. I think if you can really find both of those worlds, you're going to have a lot of success. And then also, you know, I know I'm framing that around business, but even without business, surround yourself with good people. Love is always the right answer. That's what I think I would tell him or her or whoever that might be.
Brother, that's just beautiful. I love that. All right. I want to thank our audience for joining us today. I especially want to thank Craig for coming on the show. And Craig, if somebody wanted to reach out to you to connect, what would be the best place for them to do so?
Hit me up on Instagram at Craig Sewing Media. Sewing Media. At Craig Sewing Media. That's the best place. Should be a DM. Message me, post, tag, whatever. I'll follow you back. But that's probably the best place.
And sewing is spelled S-E-W-I-N-G. So so you'll mess it up too. You'll be like suing and be like, oh no, I messed it up. It's sewing, but that's beautiful. All right. Make sure you follow, you know, you're posting nothing but great stuff, and definitely check out The American Dream. It's an awesome TV show, and I'm a huge fan. All right. This has been the Get It Done podcast. You can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, anywhere that you listen to podcasts. And if you've taken some value from the show and you want to support us, hey, you know, write us a 5-star review. Open up Apple Podcasts on your phone, scroll the way down to the bottom, tap 5-star. Just takes about 10 seconds. Really help me out. And, you know, tell a friend, hit that subscribe button. All those things make a huge difference in helping us reach more people. Once again, I am Jimmy Ryan. This has been the Get It Done podcast. Thanks so much for listening.
Thanks, man.